ziek. Good morning. Yes, so we look like the chosen few this morning. But the word of the Lord says we're two or more gathered, I'm there. So welcome. We're starting with the word this morning because we're going online. We're doing online this morning as well from here. So also good morning to everybody that joins us online. Before I share the word, I just want to say we had a leadership meeting last week in Volksrust, which was really significant meeting for us. We managed to get all the elders of all our campuses together in Volksrust, and we got a mandate from the elders, from the leaders, that M.A.R.C. ministry will be the ministry that will provide the ministry part of our campuses. So what we've done was we've drawn all our pastors, the teachers, all the fivefold, all the ministries we've drawn into M.A.R.C. ministry that will serve all the campuses. And also, we got the mandate to start the M.A.R.C. online campus as well, which Jaco and Tanet will also oversee. So it's lekker gaan lekker besig wees. But we're obviously there to help them. So because we have people online that only relates to us, but we haven't been able to give them a greater commitment from our side, which will happen now. So if you go online, so it's important if you listen to these messages to like M.A.R.C. so that you basically subscribe to the M.A.R.C. site. On YouTube you can subscribe, but on Facebook just like M.A.R.C. and then you will be able to get notifications and all the sermons on all those things. And the purpose for that was to reach out to people that are not in churches or do not find churches where they feel that they can grow. The problem with churches sometimes is you leave this church, and every church that you go to, you must start at the bottom. You must do new membership classes. You must do a week of this and a week of that. You must begin with the ushers, and people say, we just must do the basic concepts again, and people just say, we don't want to do that anymore. And so they relate with us, and we want to give them a church feel so they can become part. So that will become a campus all by itself as well. The children, is nie baie kindertjies vanmôre nie, so it looks like you're going to have fun. Is there just no, just the two of them? Okay. As hulle nie wil nie, dalk gaan hulle bietjie skaam wees om te gaan eerste keer. Okay, all right. Okay, that's right. All right, so the reason we start with the word first is because we cannot control how long the worship always is, and it's very difficult. People know that we go online. So when we're online, it starts at 9. So that's how come, of it nou Pieter hulle is of ons, we start with the word, and the people trickle in as we continue. So that is my part of what we're doing. Okay, so let's begin. Let's just pray together. Let's just ask the Lord to come and touch our hearts. Father, we just want to thank you this morning for your goodness. Thank you that you are our Father. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your presence. Every time we gather, your word says you dwell among the praises of your people. So Lord, this morning we just come before you and we say that we love you. We trust you. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your faithfulness. And Lord, even as we're not a lot of people this morning, your Spirit knew exactly who would be here today. Your Spirit knows exactly how to work with us. And even as this message goes out, we just ask, Father, that you will quicken the word inside of us, and that we will be able to receive from the presence of the Holy Spirit, that we will find the guidance of the Lord, and that we will grow in our relationship with you and also in revelation in the Word. And we thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I titled my sermon this morning, What Makes You Happy? So, it's going to be interesting. In the week I was just driving and I was just thinking how easily we feel unfulfilled as people. And the question is, what makes you tick? What makes you happy? What are the things that brings peace and joy to your life? You might say it's my children. You might say it's my hobbies. Some people it's the animals. My cats make me happy. Other people's cats don't even make me happy, and I don't have my own one. I'm not a cat person. But I've seen how people can love their cats. Say, my cats make me happy. And I know most of you say my job makes me happy. You know, most people do not work for salaries. They work because it's a joy to work. Which is not true. All right. So, but the question is, what is the level of our happiness? Are we inherently happy? Or are we striving for the next best thing? Is our life constantly just chasing the next thing that we think is going to make us happy? And we become success-driven and we become goal-orientated. Now, having goals, Uncle Trevor always said, if you aim at nothing, you'll eat it every time. So we have to have something that we focus on. That's not what I'm saying. But, you know, as you grow older, you think by yourself, what makes you happy? What makes me happy is when my children are together. That makes me happy. But it's totally impractical. My children are adults. They have their own children. The one stays in the UK, and two of them stays in Pretoria, and they don't see each other. I think we see them more than what they see each other. So, obviously, seeing us doesn't make them as happy as us seeing them. And that's also not a constant. Eating ice cream makes me happy, but I can't eat ice cream every day. I will become totally roly-poly. I can't do that. It doesn't really make me happy. Yeah, that's what we find in comfort foods. It makes me feel satisfied. That those endorphins that's released, the happy drug, the dopamine, the stuff that makes us feel good is released for a short while. But that's how people become adrenaline junkies, because they're looking for the dopamine. They're looking for that happy drug that's released. So it can't be that. So what makes us happy? Or are we happy? Mostly people just are very focused on their challenges. Most of us try to fix the things that's unfixable, or we hope that it can be fixed. Usually it's our circumstances. Sometimes it's relationships. Sometimes it's a lack of money. But then I know quite a lot of people with money, and they don't seem happy. So money inherently doesn't make us happy. Enough is good. Enough makes me happy. But that's not what I want to talk about. So I don't want to talk about the amount of money that you have. I want to talk about inherent joy, stuff that makes us feel fulfilled, stuff that makes us experience the peace of God. And I find that there's not many people, so now there's only one. All right. He's going. I know where he's going. He's going to the out room. Took this route. He wanted to call his mother to say, you must come and help me. All right. So, yeah. So what makes us happy? What is happiness? What is it possible to be happy? Is it possible to be happy all the time? Is it realistic? Because if I ask you, are you happy all the time? You're probably not. But are we with our Jesus at any time of our life? No. Jesus is our joy and our strength. So if Jesus is a constant, the indwelling Holy Spirit is a constant, promised to us by the blood, So it means the availability of happiness is a constant. So that means you and I move in and out of it. It's not that it's not there, it's there. So pretty much sometimes what we choose or how we align with it, and then we must be realistic that there are circumstances in life. You can't be happy when there's trauma happening in your life. So I don't want to talk about the outward happiness. Yes, I'm happy. A lot of people that's like that are sometimes not real. They're sometimes not that. People that's always friendly and laughing and making jokes are often not necessarily happy. They just feed off the energy of that happiness shared with other people. I mean, to make other people laugh. It gives us great joy. I like it if I can make people laugh. That's why I'm known for telling jokes. When I worked on the mine, somebody would walk 2 kilometers underground to come and tell me a joke in another section. Because I enjoy jokes, I tell jokes. I sometimes seem not to be able to forget the joke. I still have to work out whether it's a blessing or a curse. But inherently, how we feel, are we content? Do we feel the peace of the Lord? Are we happy, or are we constantly just chasing stuff that seems to be out of reach? If you think it's money, you're going to have a problem. So I was looking at the Word, all right? So we're going to look at Psalm 16. David understood something in his relationship with the Lord. And my focus is definitely to talk about the availability of joy and peace. By that, it doesn't imply that you will automatically be in it. I just want you to know that the door is open to it. Because I cannot choose for you. I cannot align for you. I cannot force you. I cannot manipulate you. I cannot emotionally engineer you into joy and peace and love and all those things. But at least it's good to know that I've got a place to go to if I want to, when I choose to. All right, I'm going to read from verse 5. Psalm 16 from verse 5. He says, O Lord, you are my portion. You are the portion of my inheritance and my cup. You maintain my lot. Gaan dit net weer lees. Hy sê, O Lord, you are my portion. You are the portion of my inheritance and my cup. You maintain my lot. The lines have fallen to me in pleasant places. Yes, I have a good inheritance. I will bless the Lord who has given me counsel. My heart also instructs me in the night seasons. I have set the Lord always before me because he is my right hand. I shall not be moved. Therefore, my heart is glad and my glory rejoices. My flesh also will rest in hope. For you will not leave my soul in Sheol, nor will you allow your Holy One to see corruption. You will show me the path of life. In your presence is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. Here's a guy that's king. Okay, this is a bit of a prophetic word about the Messiah as well. So you can read it in there. You can see David was a king and he was a prophet. So yeah, he does prophesy. He says, you will not allow your Holy One to see corruption, talks about Jesus, that Jesus won't remain dead. So it is a bit of a prophetic thing in here. But this is what he says, verse 11. He says, you will show me the path of life. In your presence is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. Now, my question is, what more do we want? If this is true, if this is a man that was not effectively born again, Jesus wasn't risen from the dead yet, and his experience in his encounter with God releases, he says, you will show me the path of life. In your presence is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. Not just goodness, pleasures. Forevermore. So nou begin ons sien, maar hier is 'n bietjie van 'n key. Here's something that is revealed to us where we say, where do I find joy? Where do I find rest? Where do I find hope? Where do I find this place? The Lord says, you will show me the path of life. I don't know about you, but for me, my whole life has been chasing things, even from a young age. I was never really satisfied with what I had. I always looked out for the more. There must be more. This can't be it. This can't be life. This can't be enough. That's why they say, you never have enough money. I've seen rich people. You know, when you are young, you are poor. Unless you are a trust baby, and I don't know a lot of them. When you are young, you are poor. When you start out, the day you marry, those of you that married, you'll know. What did you start with? Basically nothing. Everything you have, you got from somebody. The first thing we bought was a Speed Queen washing machine. Yet it was so expensive, it was like buying a car. I mean, it was, and we had it for 23 years. A Speed Queen washing machine. Our priorities were right. I gave my wife a gift. No, Speed Queen. All the other stuff we got from our parents, it wasn't about fashion or stuff. It's just stuff we needed. There was one guy that led me to the Lord, gave me a chest freezer. That thing also lasted us about 20 years. A big freezer. But I always had this thing in my heart that it wasn't enough. There must be more. So as your finances increase, so your lifestyle increases. So when you can afford it, you buy a better car. Not that the old one was broken or something, you just better car. Nicer house. When we started the ministry, my children had to do with Mr. Price tackies and stuff. As we increased in life, our salaries increased, they got the better tackies. They got a little bit, sometimes we could afford to get them some brand clothes or Under Armour at some stage. Ach, you know, when I was fine, Adidas was fine. To have Adidas tackies when I was young was perfect. These days, Adidas a little bit down on the list. It's Nike and Air stuff, you know, the Air, you know, all those kind of things. And they will learn that stuff really doesn't really satisfy. It satisfies if you can get all these gifts without working for the money that it costs. So that's a great satisfaction. But at the end of the day, as an adult, you begin to chase things. All right. So even when you marry, I mean, who wants the young men here? Who if you want an ugly wife one day? You don't want an ugly wife. Nobody wants an ugly wife. Beauty lies in the eyes of the beholder, eh? So what's beautiful to one person is not necessarily beautiful to the rest. So I don't want to determine this morning what does ugly look like and what beautiful looks like. But nobody wants an ugly wife. You're already searching and you're picking. I mean, if you want a beautiful wife and that's your standard, you must look in the mirror and ask yourself what you deserve on face value. So if you have a revelation of 139 that says, wonderful are your works and great are your works, then you can find a beautiful spouse. That's great because you think you're beautiful. But somehow we go through life and you think, well, is this it? Is this life? Is this spiritual life? Is this what it is to be a child of God? Is this what it is to be an adult? Well, then life kind of sucks for most people. And even those that have money, life sucks for them as well because they want more. If money was enough, they wouldn't want more. They want more. They want better. They want greater. An interesting quote that I read from C.S. Lewis. It was from a book that he wrote, The Weight of Glory, but just something taken out of the book of C.S. Lewis. It says, we are half-hearted creatures, fooling about with drink and sex and ambition when infinite joy is offered us. like an ignorant child who wants to go on making mud pies in a slum because he cannot imagine what is meant by the offer of a holiday at the sea. We are far too easily pleased. Now, obviously, this has just to do with what is offered to us in the revelation of who Jesus Christ is. The world will never be satisfied. You will never be on top of the world. Don't know whether you watched the news. There's two young men, one young man in Jamaica now and one young man in Botswana. These guys are going to break Usain Bolt's records in this coming 2 years. You never stay on top. When you have a problem with business on the phone and somebody gave you a bad product, what is your first response? If the salesperson doesn't satisfy you and you phone them, what is the first thing you say to them? Who do you want to talk to? They want to talk to their boss. If the manager doesn't satisfy you, who do you want to talk to? The owner. That's it. You never remain at the top. So to have a dream of reaching the top might be a pipe dream. And even when you're on the top of your own world, there's other people whose tops are higher than your tops. Even the success measured at when you think you're at top, there's somebody that's better, there's somebody that's richer, there's somebody that's got more. It's just the way life is. But we find ourselves in this position that what I have is not enough. Now, I can do nothing about that. You might say to me, Pastor, I get ambitie. I say, it's fine. I have ambition. Good luck. I also have ambition. I had ambition. I'm still ambitious with certain stuff. But the older I get, you know, when you grow older, you look back, you look forward. The time ahead is less than the time behind. And you say, if I take a trend of how I got here, maybe I must revise a little bit of what I'm expecting that's in the future. Maybe my focus is not at the right place. I listened once to a man who had a talk about success. And after the talk, I went to him, I said, thank you. It's usually that try to inspire you to focus and have goals and those kind of stuff. And I said to him, I enjoyed the talk, but I've got a problem with success. And he said, how can you possibly, because that was his theme. I said, my problem is once I've reached it, what then? Once I think I'm successful, what waits for me? What do I do? Because it can't be money. It can't be clothes, it can't be cars. A new car is only new for about 2-3 months. Then it's not new anymore. It can't be a new car. It can't be a new wife. A new wife can only be complicated. Big trouble. New wife can only be big trouble because you have to start all over again. It can't be that. It can't be physical things that creates an inner joy and an inner peace. And the word begins to reveal to us that true joy lies in the discovery of who God is and who you can be in Him. That's where the answer of true joy lies. And that's when the playing field are leveled, that you do not compare yourself to other people's successes and think, for me to be truly happy, I need that, or I need that, or I need to be like that, or I need to find that, or I need to have that. Because at the end of the day, you get those things and you say, but it doesn't satisfy me. One of my greatest ambitions was to become a pastor. I achieved that goal about 35 years ago. I remember about 3 months, it was so nice the first time after I'd been ordained. I picked up the phone, I said, hello, it's Pastor Andries, Mulder speaking. I thought, wow, this feels so good. Because the title just kind of meant something to me. 6 months down the line, I said, this is it now. No, people don't even call me pastor. I say to people, Andries is who I am, pastoring is what I do. Call me Andries. When I walk into heaven, they're going to say, Andries is here. They're not going to say, Pastor Andries is here. Prophet Andries or Apostle Jan or whatever. You say, your son's home. Lord, your son's home. And I have to fall into the room where everybody, their sons and daughters. There's no one better, higher, richer. We're all presented in Christ to the Father. So there's a playing field that's level there. So those things are not the things that satisfy us. Ministry does not satisfy us. Titles doesn't satisfy us. Money doesn't satisfy us. Now when we go to Philippians chapter 3, I'm going to read from verse 1. I already told you that it must have something to do with the revelation of Jesus Christ, the source of life, the source of joy. David already saw that, and he spoke that, he prophesied it. Philippians chapter 3, verse 1, says, finally, my brethren, rejoice in the Lord. Rejoice in the Lord. For me to write these same things to you is not tedious, but for you it is safe. Beware of dogs, beware of evil workers, beware of the mutilation. You know what mutilation is? It's when you mutilate the flesh. He's actually talking about people that are making a claim on the power of the circumcision, basically the law, basically being a Jew. A Jew circumcised on the eighth day, the boys. In the revelation of Christ, he doesn't call that a holy thing anymore. He says it's a mutilation of the flesh. He says, beware of the mutilation. For we are the circumcision. We are the circumcision who worship God in the Spirit, rejoice in Christ Jesus, and have no confidence in the flesh. Though I also might have confidence in the flesh, if anyone else thinks he may have confidence in the flesh, I am also circumcised the eighth day of the stock of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of the Hebrews, concerning the law, a Pharisee, concerning zeal, persecuting the church, concerning the righteousness which is in the law, blameless. So all the fleshly legal requirements, he says, I qualify. I've got reason to boast a little bit, because I'm itzy. In the eyes of people, I'm something. In the eyes of the law, I'm something. This is such a bold claim. He almost says that he is the perfect Jew. But then, remember, he was persecuting the church, and then Jesus appeared to him on the road to Damascus, and he had this experience, and he was born again, and the revelation of who Jesus was came to him. And verse 7 says, but what things were gained to me, these I have counted loss for Christ. Yet indeed, I also count all things lost for the excellence of the knowledge of Jesus Christ, my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish that I might gain Christ and be found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness which is from God by faith, that I may know him, the power of his resurrection, the fellowship of his sufferings, being conformed to his death, if by any means I may attain to the resurrection from the dead. Verse 12, not that I have already attained or am already perfected, but I press on. And here's a belangrijke ding, hoor wat sê. I press on that I may lay hold of that for which Christ Jesus has also laid hold of me. I will not tell you. I say, but I press on that I may lay hold of that for which Jesus Christ has also laid hold of me. He says, I want to find that thing on why Jesus came. I want to find that thing of why Jesus laid hold of me. I want to find the thing that caused Jesus to come in the flesh. I want to find the purpose of why he came and willfully died for me, for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross. He says, and everything that I achieved in the natural, it fed me for a while, but when this greater thing was revealed to me, I counted as loss. I counted as rubbish in my life. I let go of it because I've seen something that is greater that, and I want to lay hold of that. I want to lay hold of that of for which Jesus laid hold of me. So I want to get behind the purpose of why Jesus came. Why did Jesus come? Why did Jesus die on the cross? Because here you are. You know how much he loves you. You know that nothing can separate you from the love of God which is in Christ. You know that nothing, no one can steal you out of his hand. You know that God claimed you. That he bought you with his blood. You were bought at a price. You know that you were given a name that's above all names. You were given eternal life, eternal promises. You have the full attention of the Godhead, of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. You have the commitment of his presence for the rest of your existence, not the rest of your life. The promise is the Holy Spirit will be with you forever. Not until you die, or until the end of the age. And this is what he says. He says, brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended, but one thing I do, forget those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead. So, something happened. Something happened with Paul. A revelation came that superseded all the other desires of the flesh and that which he could do in his own flesh. I often say this to people. You know, some people are just born lucky. Their parents are rich. So they can go to the best schools. They get the best opportunities. They get the best of what the parents can give, relevant to what the parents have. They're just lucky. I was the other day looking at the English king's children. You're born a prince. Yes, how cool is that? Yeah, you are. You were born of just a normal family. Here in Kriel, most of our parents worked on the mines or power stations. That's about it. If you were lucky, your dad might have been an engineer. Then you would have lived in a little bit of a bigger house, but that's about it. Might have been the mine manager. Yeah, then you would probably would have gone to a better school than the rest of us, but that's about it. So some people are born lucky. Then we come to Jesus, and he says, it doesn't matter where you've been born. It doesn't matter who your parents were. It doesn't matter how much money you have. It doesn't matter what your IQ is. It doesn't matter whether you were head boy or head girl. I always say it's very important in primary school if you're chosen as head boy, or prefect, head boy, first team rugby. It builds your self-esteem. It's good for you. It's not a bad thing. But when you're as old as I am, nobody cares whether you were head boy or head girl. Nobody cares whether you were the first team player or whether you were captain. Nobody cares. Nobody cares whether you broke records when you ran the 100 meters. They don't even talk about it. Nobody cares. Your children might care. Your grandchildren might care because of it's sentimental. But the world doesn't care. So it was a great achievement for the time. It helped your self-esteem. It helped you to show who you are, but today, nobody really cares. And it's not that important. What I'm trying to say is there's things that's more important than that. This is what Paul says. Paul says, I've been loving God, I've been fighting for God, I've been persecuting the church, and then Jesus came, he says, my whole life changed. And he says, actually now the victories and the accolades I received from people, I actually count as loss now, because those things do not define me. But why? So there are two areas here. The one is the natural world, and the other one is the spiritual world. In the natural world, these things count. In the natural world, people want to associate with what they perceive as success. So if you are rich, if you have a lot of money, you tend to have a lot of friends. It's not that your friends want your money. They just want to be associated with you who are perceived to be successful. It was a philosophy in the church. It says if you want to be rich, mix with rich people. If you want to be clever, mix with clever people. A lot of people go to mega churches where the building is a 50 million rand building. They don't really care what gospel is preached in it. They just want to associate with what looks successful. It is wow. The people that go there have nice clothes. They drive nice cars. They have the best musicians. They present the best things. I don't have to be able to sing like that. I just want to be where they sing like that. I just want to be where people are successful. I'm sick and tired of people that are struggling all the time. Listen, you shouldn't go there because you're probably pulling the standard down a bit. I've always said it. Don't go to a perfect home cell. If you find a perfect home cell, don't go there. The moment you join it, it's not perfect anymore. Well, I'm just trying to say, be humble, man. You're not as good as you think you are. There's always somebody that's better. It doesn't supposed to make you bad. It just says, that can't be the standard. Now, Hebrews chapter 12, I'm going to read from verse 1. It says, therefore we also, since we are surrounded by so great cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us. Let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. For the joy that was set before him. So here we have Jesus coming in the likeness of man. Jesus knew what was Isaiah 53. Isaiah 53 explains the suffering of the Christ. Jesus knew Isaiah 53. So Jesus read in Isaiah, he read in the Psalms, he read in the Old Testament what his suffering would look like before he even went to the cross. But the word says, for the joy that was set before him. What kind of joy is that now? Because he knew what suffering he would face on the cross, but he died on the cross for the joy that was set before him. It means that there is a greater truth. There's something greater here that at play. There's something that supersedes the threat of natural life's woes, the thing in the natural life that can cause us to be troubled. There was something greater in the life of Jesus that made it possible for him to endure the sufferings and live life as a natural man so that he can be victorious. What was that great thing? It was the heart of the Father. Jesus came to represent the kingdom of God. He had it. He knew what it was. He had a revelation. And I gaan nou 'n bietjie vir julle lees wat sê vir die Fariseërs. There is something that he says that reveals a little bit to us. And that's my message to you today, is to say, listen, if it's earthly things you're chasing, I just want to say to you, it's never going to be enough. Doesn't matter how good you are. It's not bad to have it. I think God wants his children to prosper. But it's no use. You have all the gold in the world, but you're not happy. And you have no peace in your life. And yes, onvergenoegd. It means, yes, I get it. I mean, can you remember when South Africa won the World Cup? Man, 1995 was like a miracle. I remember it so well. Now, when 4 years back when we won the World Cup, it was great. It was really great. But kind of when we won it 2 times in a row, it was like I just wasn't as excited as I was the first time. And about a month after the World Cup, I did not think about rugby anymore. Going up to the World Cup, doing the finals, quarterfinals, I didn't miss a game. I watched it because it was like, this is great. I mean, when we won France, it was like winning the World Cup to me. But when we actually won it, and it was great for a day or two, and then it was just done. It was like, okay, what's the next thing? Oh, it's 4 years. In 4 years, we have another World Cup again. It just doesn't last. That's the thing. The successes in the natural doesn't last. It's like a new car. My first car, I was much more excited about my first car that I had than when I bought a new car after that. And my first car was a Beetle, a yellow one, an SP. It was great. Those SPs were great cars those days. I remember, it was like, my heart was, I was more excited than the first girlfriend I had. It was just like, wow, this is great. And then as life goes on, that's what happens. You buy cars. Because we need cars. The first house I bought was, oh, this is ours. My vrou, this is ons in a prysie here. But as life goes on, you say, this is just another house. This is, it's because it can't satisfy us anymore. We've tasted that. But now the Lord comes and says, but listen, there's something you must taste that is much greater than this. You must taste the goodness of God. David writes in the Psalms, he says, oh, taste and see that God is good. Now, if you go to Genesis chapter 15, this is so powerful. You know, when God began with Abraham, Abraham was the father of faith. God, only in Abraham, God chose a lineage. If it wasn't for Abraham, there would be no Jews. There would be no lineage. He's the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Jacob, in the Old Testament, if you read Jacob, often it talks about Israel, the nation. He says, oh, Jacob, he talks to the Israelites, calls them Jacob. But in Genesis 15, verse 1, listen to this. He says, after these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision, saying, do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield, your exceedingly great reward. Jesus went to the cross for the joy that was set before him. What drove Jesus to the cross? His revelation of who God the Father was. Here God the Father comes and said to Abraham, not Abraham yet. He says, I am your exceedingly great reward. Abraham said, Lord God, what will you give me, seeing I go childless and the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus? And Abraham said, look, you have given me no offspring. Indeed, one born. I don't want to continue there, otherwise I'll keep you here forever. But then he said, I have no children. Then God showed him the stars in the heaven, the sand. He says, your descendants will be like this. Now imagine, here's a guy, he's old, he's about 90, close to 100 years old. He has no heir. The Lord appears in a dream. He says, I'm your exceedingly great reward. He says, what will you show me that this is true? He says, your children, your nageslag sal wees soos die sterre van die hemel, sand van die see. Hier het nie 'n kind nie. And they are past childbearing age, and God gives the promise. But in it, he says, I am your exceedingly great reward. He says, I am your reward. Not the stuff I give, the stuff I provide, the paths I open up, the blessings. He says, I am your reward. Your exceedingly great reward. I am your shield. I'm your protector. And then later on, that's a very good example of to see what a covenant, how a covenant worked when God made a covenant with him. It means that God says, I will now unite myself with you. See, Jesus, you know, when Jesus was speaking to the woman at the pit, disciples went to buy food, they came back. Jesus was speaking to this woman that had bad reputation. And they were amazed that he spoke to him. And then they said, here's food. He said, my food is to do the will of my Father. So Jesus came forth from the Father. There's scripture that says Jesus is in the bosom of the Father. So Jesus is a representation of the heart of God. So why did Jesus come to this earth? Why did Jesus die for us on the cross? Why this whole story? So that we can come to that exceedingly great reward. So that we can come to the place where we say, I know God. God gave, I'm in the life that God creates, that God gives. Because in that is fullness of joy. So So that's where our joy is. So if today, if we look at the church, we would say, then why are we not joyful? And I have to ask myself, because I'm unfulfilled. I feel I have an unfulfilled life. And sometimes I'm chasing things that I think will make me happy, and then it takes a lot of energy, it takes a lot of sacrifices in the natural, and then when they come, because it's a principle of life, you get what you put in. It's like an ATM. If you put money in the bank, you can withdraw. If you stop putting money in the bank, there's no withdrawal. So life is a lot about what you put in, you can get out. It's true. If you work hard, there's rewards for us. But when those rewards come, you just say, but why am I not feeling satisfied? Because it was never meant to satisfy you. It was just meant to provide for you. That's all it was designed to provide for you. But your design is to find satisfaction in the reward of faith, which is what? Which is to have an intimate relationship with God. And there the playing field is level. It doesn't matter whether you were born rich. It doesn't matter whether you were born with a high IQ. It doesn't matter whether, you know, you are white, black, Indian, doesn't really matter. Because in Christ there's a new creation. Elizabeth Elliot wrote, she says, the world looks for happiness through self-assertion. The Christian knows that joy is found in self-abandonment. If a man let himself be lost for my sake, Jesus said, he will find his true self. The key is to lose your life and find the life that he gives. Because in your natural life, there is literally nothing that can satisfy. It doesn't matter how high you go. It doesn't matter how much you have. It doesn't matter how good it is. I remember Joe Donato was a mafia boss. Joe Donato. Did he ever minister there where you guys were those years? Joe Donato was, I think, he's still on, at that stage, I'm talking about 25 years back, 30 years back, he ministered to us. He was a mafioso. He was in the mafia, the Italian mafia. And at that stage, he was still on 10 organizations' hit list. He says in the one morning, he woke up in his mansion, and he had this estate. He said, I stood up from my waterbed. Those days it was the thing. He says, and I stood there on my balcony and I looked at this. He says, and I just realized, but this can't be what life is about. He says, I was totally unhappy. He says, but I literally could buy anything that I wanted. Yet there was an emptiness. And then he found Jesus and he became a minister of the gospel. And very much like Paul. He gave up everything. He says, it means nothing to me. Now, if we look at John chapter 3, and I've shared John chapter 3 so many times, but I'm going to start at 27, verse 27. He says, John answered and said, a man can receive nothing unless it was given to him from heaven. You yourselves bear me witness that I said, I am not the Christ, but I have been sent before him. He who has the bride is the bridegroom. But the friend of the bridegroom who stands and hears him rejoices greatly because of the bridegroom's voice. Therefore, this joy of mine is fulfilled. He must increase, but I must decrease. He who comes from above is above all. And he who is of the earth is earthly. And speaks of the earth. He who comes from heaven is above all. And what he has seen and heard, that he testifies, and no one receives his testimony. John the Baptist is telling us who Jesus is. But he makes a statement here. It's a powerful statement. He says, he who comes from above is above all. He who is of the earth is earthly and speaks of the earth. He who comes from heaven is above all. So we have earth, we've got heaven. In the earth, money and power and influence is the thing. Prosperity, self-righteousness. Now, if we go back to verse 2 of John chapter 3, Jesus gives us a hint here. Nicodemus says, what must I do to inherit the kingdom? He says, this man came to Jesus by night and he said, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him. Jesus asked and said to him, most assuredly I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Nicodemus said to him, how can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born? Jesus answered, most assuredly I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I said to you, you must be born again. Jesus brings now a distinction in identity. That which is born of flesh is flesh, that which is born of spirit is spirit. Now, if you look at the word born again, if you go and look at the Greek lexicon, the word again is anoten. Anoten is, that means, it's a Greek word that means, by analogy, to be from the first, to be anew, to be from above. So Jesus says, Nicodemus, unless you are born from above, you cannot see the kingdom of God. He sets the criteria. He says, here we have the world. Jesus came to this world for the joy that was set before him. He came to bring reconciliation with God, because the ultimate goal is that man have a relationship with God, that man experience this relationship. And in order to experience it, there must be a change in identity. You must move from being born from beneath to being born from above. So we say, are you happy? That's how I started. What makes you happy? And I'm here to tell you, nothing on this earth will make you happy. The happiness that the earth does provide is short-lived. It's not that you are unhappy. It's just that the happiness that the world gives does not satisfy. The nice thing about food is, I like pizza, man, pizza. The feeling of being full, it's a comforting feeling. I'm sure most of you know how that feels. Jy honger is, jy eet 'n pizza, of course. En jy is nou versadig en sê, that was nice. I feel good. Yeah, just because you're satisfied. But it doesn't last, because you will become hungry again. Jesus says, if you drink the water I give, you will not thirst again. So we want to exchange the things that gives us temporary joy to the things that give us eternal joy. We do not want to discard the things that gives us joy. We don't want to make them bad. I just want to say there is something that supersedes that. There's something that is greater. Because otherwise you're going to find yourself in a place where I am and where you probably are often, is to say, what is this life about? Why do I feel so unfulfilled? Why don't I always feel this joy? I'm not always happy, guys. I don't always feel happy. Sometimes I feel pretty depressed. I know I'm the only one, but I'm just sharing my testimony with you a bit. I look at life and I feel frustrated because I cannot make the stuff that I need. I cannot move other people to do it. I refuse to move people to do that for me in the first place. And the second thing is, I'm just so unfulfilled with my short term. Even when I'm good, I'm not good enough. It doesn't satisfy me. You know, I do a lot of weddings, and often when we do weddings, when you do the pre-marriage counseling, the second session is one flesh. And in the one flesh, we talk about your personal relationship with God. And over the years, I've led hundreds of couples to Jesus. Because you can't marry if you're not born again. It makes no sense. So I lead them to Jesus. And I drive home and I feel so fulfilled. Tears would run down my eyes, and I would say, God, this is what I live for. Just to lead people to you. You know, the feeling of leading somebody to Jesus, nothing gets to it. But a week later, I'm unfulfilled. It doesn't feed you. It's nice now. It's like when your children excel and you are so proud. It's a wonderful time. Nothing is wrong with it. Enjoy it. I mean, your children's successes are our honor. But it doesn't last. It must be something greater. There must be something that's a bit more life meaning and makes us feel joy and peace. Kingdom of God is righteousness, peace, and joy. And, you know, Jesus, I'm almost done here. In John chapter 8, verse 21. Jesus reveals to us the possibility of you finding yourself in this life that's from above. We've now realized that which is from beneath is temporary. I read a book once that says all your trophies will one day be crushed by someone. And it is true. Stuff that you're sentimental about, two generations down the line, nobody's going to care about it. You can have trophies and they say, my dad was good at golf, or my granddad was good at... I have won, my grandfather won a trophy in pigeon racing. A big trophy like this, pigeon racing. I still have it today, but it doesn't really mean much to me. But I'm sure to him it was this great thing. But to me it means nothing. I didn't even know he had pigeons. I don't care about his pigeons. I'm caring about my own stuff, my own battles. My own family, my own provision, my own budget. That's what I care about. I don't care about this. It's not long-lasting. Even if it lasts you your lifetime, it's not everlasting. And now Jesus comes and he presents something that's just bigger than this. He says, on the right, in God's right hand, there is this joy, there is this provision, there's this life of abundance. And yes, it is great, but it's so much greater with Jesus. You know, it's so much greater when there's this eternal value as well, because I've got inherent joy, and my life's joy and purpose is not determined by this. So whether I have it, whether I don't have it, it doesn't really matter. Paul says that. He says, I know what it is to have in abundance, and I know what it is to have in loss. He says, I know what it is to be on the mountaintop, and I know what it is to be in the valley. And whenever I'm confronted by life and my fears for life, and a lot of my fears revolve around my children, what can I say? Because I can't choose for them, I can't decide for them, I can't work for them, I can't work them. They must work themselves, they must achieve themselves, they must make decisions themselves, and I see with open eyes how they sometimes make wrong decisions. Fix me. You're not in control. You do not possess your children. They possess themselves. When you're in the ministry and you love people and you see the pain that they go through and you see how life knocks people around, just the unpredictability of life, when you see people having to deal with death, we've had a lot of it in this last month, people that we love that died, how people deal with loss, how struck down they are, how broken they are. You see, when people really need money, you see people in financial dire straits, you see people fighting sicknesses and diseases, you see children being depressed, you see our children being treated unfairly, you look at the political situation in the country, you think, oh my God, what's going to happen to South Africa? You begin to carry the burdens of other people. There must be a place where you must go for joy. There is a place. You're already in that place. You're already in it's already in the room. You're there. John chapter 8, 21. Jesus said to them again, I am going away, and you will seek me, and will die in your sin. Where I go, you cannot come. So the Jews said to him, will he kill himself because he says, where I go, you cannot come? And he said to them, I see it. I'm not sure whether other, you know, sometimes you see something, you see it, and you're not sure whether other people see it. But this to me is like, this is amazing. He said to them, you are from beneath, I'm from above. You are of this world, I am not of this world. Therefore I said to you that you will die in your sins. For if you do not believe that I am he, you will die in your sins. Then they asked him, who are you? Jesus said to them, just what I have been saying to you from the beginning. But he makes a statement. He says, you are from beneath, I'm from above. You are of this world, I'm not of this world. John chapter 3, Jesus says, if you're not born from above, you will not see the kingdom of God. John chapter 8, 27. They did not understand that he spoke to them of the Father. Then Jesus said to them, when you lift up the Son of Man, then you will know that I am he, and that I do nothing of myself, but as my Father taught me, I speak these things. And he said, and he who sent me is with me. The Father has not left me alone, for I always do those things that please him. And Jesus gives us the key. The key of the very first scripture I shared with you. Because prophetically, David was talking about the Christ, but he says in Psalm 16, you will show me the path of life. In your presence is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. And it was attained in Christ, in your faith in Jesus Christ. Simple as that. Your faith in Jesus Christ. When you accepted Jesus as Lord and Savior, you are born from above. And the world opens up to you. And he says, this world might gift you things. This world might provide you with opportunities. In this world, you might even be lucky. But he says, the everlasting joy doesn't lie there. The everlasting joy lies in the reality of God's grace in your born-again life that's born from above, where God is your exceedingly great reward. And he's your shield. So if you sit here, what I do when I'm bombarded by this significant in life thing, I just go to the Father. That's all I do. Because the word says, the sufferings we go through cannot be compared to the glory that shall be revealed. Even if I'm in a tough time, I know it's just a season. Because nothing can separate me from the love of God, which is in Christ. I have something that is greater than my realities. I have something that's greater than my inabilities. I have something greater than the truth and reality of my life. I have something that's greater than the way I grew up. I have something that's greater than my deficits in my growing up. I have something greater than my molestation. I have something greater than my alcoholic father. I have something greater than all my failures in life. I have something greater than all my own inabilities, because the world will treat you like a chappie. It will chew you until the flavor is gone, and then it will spit you out. That's the world we live in. Julle weet hoeveel begrafnisse doen ek in hierdie kerk, nee, it's like, I've done, over the last 28 years, I've done literally hundreds of funerals, hundreds. And I see the people cry, and I see the people talk, and I see your co-workers will come up and they will say, what great man you are. 3 months down the line, nobody cares anymore. A month down the line, somebody else is doing your job. They're doing your job, they're getting your salary. Because the world doesn't care about you. The world only cares what they can get out of you. But the Father came and says, I will lead by example. I will give my life so that you can have life. And all I want you to do is give up yours. And it is that quote that I read. Ek wil hom net gou kry so vir julle. Elizabeth Elliot that said, the world looks for happiness through self-assertion. Man, as jy dit wil hê, moet jy dit self doen. Harde werk, self-assertion. I think that's where my happiness lies. The Christian knows that joy is found in self-abandonment. When Jesus says, when the Son of Man is risen, if you look up to the cross, when He's risen, you will know that I am He. When the Son of Man is lifted up. You see, when Jesus is lifted up before you, you will have a choice whether you want to believe that or not. In your natural world, you have to give up something. You know what you have to give up? Can you remember? Most of you had already did it, so I'm not shocking you. I'm telling you what you did. You gave up your life. The Word says if you lose your life, you will find it. He died for you on that cross. Faith takes you to His death, and then faith takes you to His resurrection. You died. You lose yourself. When you lose yourself, you will find yourself. In the life that's from above, is joy abundantly, is peace abundantly. So I don't know whether you're going to grow old. There's some of you that's already there. By God's grace. But it doesn't really matter. Because you've already found the essence of life. Jesus, He will show you the ways of life. And I find that a lot of Christians have the inability to do that. They have the inability to tell themselves, listen, God is bigger than this. It's possible for me. God will not let me go. He will not forsake me. And His kingdom is righteousness, peace, and joy. It's okay if not everything works out. It's okay if not every dream is achieved. It's okay. I'm going to do my best. I'm going to give it a shot. We grew up. I mean, who's good in athletics? Who of you were good in athletics in primary school? Did you become a Springbok athlete? Why not? But in primary school, every parent thinks their children's going to become a Springbok. And you probably thought by yourself you're going to become a Springbok or Protea or what. These days, not everything is Springboks anymore. That's the world. It's fine. Give it everything you have, but don't let that be the thing that feeds you. Don't let that be the thing that defines you, because it doesn't have the ability to do. Even the highest success rate in the world is not comparable to the life that you find in Christ. It doesn't feed you the same way. It doesn't define you the same way. And this one was by grace and love. And it defines you as a child of God. And in that, the exceeding and great reward is the goodness of God to your life. Now that's something that makes sense to me, and it gives me kind of a relief to say, okay, so I don't have to be the best at everything. I just have to be the best at being me. If I compare it to you, I might come short, but I am the best I can be. It makes me feel happy. It makes me feel fulfilled. Because in Him I live and move and have my being. He is my joy. He is my peace. And that's the only way I make it in this stupid world. Because this world is truly stupid. It's chasing after money and it's taking everybody captive in it. I mean, I always look at the lotto, you know. I know nobody here plays the lotto. But it is tempting when you get the message from the bank that say it's now 750 million rand. Powerball. You think, what costs a car key? Can just buy one, 2 rand. But, you know, if you don't have a horse in the race, you can't win the race. But you know what your chances are? You got a better chance, statistically. You got a better chance to be struck by lightning than win the lotto. But you think, what will I do with that million, that 370 million? It means that somewhere in our life, there's something just put into us to say, money, I need money, I need money. I need money. Yeah, we need money. We need money. But more than money, we need God. We need peace and joy. Otherwise, we grow old. And you know what? We miss out on Priscilla. We miss out on life because we've been chasing something that could never be caught. And that gives no honor to God. Because when we are young, we give our life to Jesus, and our whole life, we are unfulfilled chasing things that's unattainable. He is our reward. If God wants you to have money, you're going to have money. You're going to have money. But I'd rather go for health than money. So what makes you happy? Are you happy? You know what they say? Come on, man. Tell your face you're happy. What makes you happy? What are we chasing in life? Sometimes we just miss the beautiful things in life that is so rewarding because we're unfulfilled. Don't step into that trap. God says today, He says, I'm your exceedingly great reward. Eternal life in the presence of the peace giver, the joy giver. The Lord is your joy and your strength. Ministry will not make you happy. Take it from me. Ministry is not what people think it is. I spoke to a person this week, want to become a pastor. I says, are you sure? He says, the statistics, the fallout rate of people in the pastoral, the people that survive ministry is a one-digit percentage. It's 9% and lower. The fallout rate of theological students is 90%. He says, this is not what I thought it is. Yes, you're right. Because it's God's. No man owes it. We're just obedient in it. But it's not easy. Ministry will not fulfill you. Success will not fulfill you. Degrees will not fulfill you. Money can fulfill you, but it can also corrupt you. So be aware. Amen. Shall we pray? Because we've got communion now, and we're going to go offline once I've finished praying. And then I will just share something about that. So, Father, we just want to thank you that we can actually say it. I don't know whether we fully believe it. Is that you are our exceedingly great reward. That we've been united to you, Father, in Christ Jesus. That we have all things. That we possess all things in Christ. Jesus says it. That all things the Father has is His. And Lord, then you say the Holy Spirit will declare it to us. So, we understand theoretically that the kingdom is ours, Lord, but forgive us because we have no clue what it means. We are so easily satisfied by the things the world presents, and then we do not search for the true things with you. Forgive us for that, Lord. Help us. Help us to get there. Help us to find joy in those things. I bless each and every person here today. We want to thank you for your goodness and your forbearance. You are indeed the great I am. You are indeed the one true, only God, and we worship you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Now, when we use communion,